بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I welcome you to another episode of our series السفرة الكرام, where we try to strive to be in the company of the holy angels by learning how to recite the Quran, by learning the science of Tajweed. As is our methodology, we try to start off our episode with an interesting factoid about the Quran, and then we move on to the actual rules of Tajweed. In our previous episode, we had started discussing the history of the compilation of the Quran. We'll continue along that line, and we'll say that in the early stages, it is recorded that the Quran was written down by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, the primary way of preservation at this early stage was the memorization of the Quran by the companions. This is because the Arabs of that time, they used to pride themselves in their sharp memory. In fact, this was how they preserved their oral traditions. This was how they preserved their history, their poetry, their literary legacy. They would memorize it, and then they would narrate it later on. And so when the Quran came down, the companions of the time, they memorized the portions of the Quran that were convenient to them. And many of them, in fact, memorized the entire Quran that was revealed until that time. However, in the Madani stage, when the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina, here we have clear-cut narrations that the Prophet ﷺ would actually command for the Quran to be written down. Once when a verse was revealed, and this is authentically narrated in Sahih Bukhari, he said, "Call Zayd ibn Thabit for me." Zayd ibn Thabit was the primary secretary of the Prophet ﷺ. He said, "Call him for me and tell him to bring the scapula bone and the ink pot," meaning pen and paper of their time. So when Zayd ibn Thabit came, the Prophet ﷺ dictated to him the ayah, and so Zayd wrote it down, and it is also narrated that the Prophet ﷺ would then listen back from Zayd what he had written in the Quran. So the Quran was definitely preserved by memorization and by being written down, and we'll continue along this history in our next episode. In our previous episode, we were discussing the rules of Nun Sakina and Tanween. Remember, Nun Sakina is a Nun upon which there is a Sukun, and a Tanween is a double Fatha, a double Dhamma, or a double Kasra. Moving along those lines, we have said that there are four rules of Nun Sakina and Tanween depending on the letter that occurs after it. So we now move on to the second rule, and that is that of Iqlab, or conversion. Okay, we have this fancy diagram here to help you memorize what we mean by Iqlab. Iqlab means conversion. When does Iqlab occur? Iqlab, this conversion or this changing, it occurs when a Nun Sakina or a Tanween is a change to a meme. This is why we call it iqlab. You change the Nun Sakina, or you change the Tanween from an N sound, N sound, into a M, a meme sound. Therefore, because it is converted, we call it iqlab, which means to convert, to change. Okay, well, when does this occur? It occurs when the Nun Sakina or Tanween is followed by the letter Ba. So if someone asks you, what are the letters of iqlab? You will say Ba. Only one letter. It is the letter Ba. Anytime the letter Ba occurs after a Nun Sakina or a Tanween, instead of pronouncing the N sound, you pronounce the M sound. Okay? And it is important when you do this, by the way, that you do a Ghunna. Remember, what was a Ghunna? Who remembers?
Nasal sound.
The nasal sound. The Ghunna was a nasal sound. Okay? An example here is the word Al-Anbiya. Alif Nun Sakin Ba Ya. Okay, here we have Nun Sakin Al An, but it's followed by a Ba, so we don't pronounce it Al An. We change the Nun into a Meme, and then we do a Ghunna. Okay, Al Anbiya, Al Anbiya. We change the Nun into a Meme, and we perform a Ghunna on it. Likewise, in the next example, we have a Nun Sakin followed by a Ba. Notice that this was in one word, this is in two words. It's the same ruling. There's no difference if it's in one word or two words or Tanween. It's all the same ruling. Here we have Min Ba'di. Min Ba'di. We have Nun Sakin followed by a Ba. How do we pronounce it? Mim Ba'di. Mim Ba'di. Likewise, we have Sami'an Basira. Again, we have the Tanween over here followed by a Ba. سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. We change the Tanween into a meme, and that is called إقلاب. One last example. زَوْجٍ بَهِيج. Same thing applies. We have a Tanween followed by a Ba. So we convert the noon into a meem. زَوْجٍ بَهِيجٍ. Okay, let's recite an example. Amr, why don't you recite verse 31? The brothers look it up. Verse 31 of Surah Baqarah. It begins with وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Why don't you recite these verses and we will try to spot where the iqlabs are. Okay, استعذ بالله. Verse 31 of Surah Baqarah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وعلم آدم الأسماء كلها ثم عرضهم على الملائكة فقال أنبئوني بأسماء هؤلاء إن كنتم صادقين قالوا سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم قال يا آدم أنبئهم بأسمائهم فلما أنبأهم بأسمائهم قال ألم أقل لكم
حسبك يا عم جزاك الله خير. Now notice here we have three iqlabs. The first one is in the 31st surah. قال أنبئوني. We have a noon ساكن followed by a ba. Notice here that the people who are writing the mushaf, they have added a small meme on top of the noon. This is to show you there is an iqlab there. Okay, to show you, if you didn't have the meem there, you should know the rule of tajweed. Suppose you don't know the rule of tajweed, they have shown you here that there is a iqlab. Now, we discussed in a previous episode that there is a type of meem which means that you should stop. There is a slight difference between this meem and that meem. One of the differences is that this meem, the meem of iqlab, the line after the meem goes straight down. Whereas the meem which tells you to stop, the line keeps on going horizontally. Likewise, we find two more iqlabs in verse number 33. أَمْبِئْهُمْ and أَمْبَأَهُمْ. Both times we have the noon sakina followed by a ba. So I think that rule is pretty clear, that the second rule of noon sakina and tanween is that of conversion or iqlab. And this occurs when the noon sakina or tanween is followed by a ba. What do? You convert the noon to the meem with a ghunna. Okay. The third rule of the four is that of merging. So we have a diagram here of things merging. And these diagrams, by the way, they help you to memorize it. When you think of idgham, think of something merging so you remember what the idgham is. Okay? So the idgham is of two types. There is one type of merging or idgham in which you do a ghunna and one type in which you don't do a ghunna. Today we'll only discuss the type which you don't do a ghunna, and in our next episode we'll discuss the idgham in which you do a ghunna. Okay, what exactly is an idgham? What exactly is idgham? The idgham means you merge the word before the tanween or the noon sakina into the word after the tanween or the noon sakina. Excuse me, the letter before the noon and to the letter after the noon. What happens to the noon itself? Well, when there's no ghunna, as in these two cases of the lam and the ra, it is completely dropped. And that is why we call it idgham or merging. You merge what is before with what is after, and you drop the actual sound of na, the tanween or the noon sakina. And the two letters of idgham without ghunna are lam and ra. So anytime you have a noon sakina followed by a lam, or you have a tanween followed by a lam, or a tanween followed by a ra, or a noon sakina followed by a ra, you drop the sound of n and you merge what is before with what is after. Let's give an example here. We have over here min rabbihim. Notice we have a noon sakina followed by a ra, and the ra is a letter of idgham without ghunna. So you don't say min rabbihim, you drop it. You drop the noon and you merge the meem with the ra, and you say mil rabbihim immediately. Likewise, in the next example, ghafuran rahima. Ghafuran, there's a tanween, okay, followed by a ra. You don't say غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. You say غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. You don't hear an N sound because you drop it. Likewise, هُدًى لِلْمُحْسِنِينَ. The same applies here. You have a dal with a tanween, and then you have a lam. Hudan lil muhsinin. Hudan lil muhsinin. Again, you don't say hudan. If you said hudan, then that would be incorrect. The whole point is that you merge what is before it with what is after it. We have another two more examples. Waylun likulli humazatin lumaza. We have a tanween on the ta. Humazatin lumaza. You didn't hear the N sound, it was dropped. Yeah. Likewise, we have in Surah Al-Ikhlas, لَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ لَمْ يَكُلْ يَكُنْ. Look what happened to the noon, dropped. Suppose you were to stop, then you have to say لَمْ يَكُنْ. You ran out of breath or something, you have to say the noon. But if you go on, then it is not allowed to say the noon, rather you merge what is before the noon with what is after the noon, and that is why it is called idgham, that you merge what is before it with what is after it. Now open up Surah Al-Alaq. We probably don't have time to recite, but we will just point out some examples in Surah Al-Alaq. Surah Al-Alaq, as you know, is the first surah of the Quran that was revealed. If you go to the last few ayat, we have over here, let's look at verse number 7. Okay, verse number 7. Allahu istaghna. What is over here? We have the noon sakina followed by a ra. So how do we pronounce it? Allahu istaghna. Now here as a side point, remember when we were talking about the rules of the ra, we said one of the most common mistakes with the ra is what? The rolling of the ra. You repeat it. Someone make the mistake while they recite. Someone, Amr, why don't you make the mistake? Suppose you roll the ra, how would it sound then? Arra, exactly. This is a common mistake. So make sure that when you do this idgham, you don't fall into the other mistake of rolling the ra. Okay? Samir, why don't you pronounce it properly?
Arra'ahu istaghna.
Exactly. Arra'ahu istaghna. Likewise, if you look at verse number 15. Okay?
كَلَّا لَئِن لَّمْ يَنْتَهِ لَنَسْفَعًا بِالنَّاصِيَةِ.
Where is the idgham without ghunnah?
لَئِلَّمْ.
Exactly, okay? لَئِلَّمْ. So we have over here the noon sakina followed by a lam. And when we have this, then we drop out the noon and we pronounce it with the hamza immediately merges with the lam, and that is why we call it an idgham. Okay, طيب, we have only time for a short surah, so let us recite Surah Al-Ikhlas because that too has an idgham to it.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
قل هو الله أحد.
قل هو الله أحد.
Quick review. The lam in the word Allah, is it heavy or light?
Heavy.
Why?
Heavy.
Was it
preceded by fatha? Preceded by a fatha, exactly. What did we do on the dal in ahad?
Qalqala.
Okay, remember we're going to revise the rules as we go on.
Allahu as-samad.
Allahu as-samad.
Okay, the lam in as-samad, why did we not pronounce it?
Solar.
It's a solar letter. The sad is a solar letter, which means we drop the lam when we have the alif lam there.
Lam yalid wa lam yulad.
لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ.
Likewise, both of the qalqas are on the dal.
وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ.
وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ.
Okay, what happened here with the idgham? You see it clearly, the noon sakin before it is, after it is
alam.
And alam we studied right now is of the letters of idgham without ghunnah. So we drop the noon and we connect what is before it, which is the kaf, to with it, what is after it, and that is the noon, the lam.
Walam yakul yakul.
There is no n sound. It is merged. It is dropped in the merging of what is before and what is after. And the last point here, kufuwan. How did we pronounce the noon there?
Clear.
Idhar, clear. Why? Because what is after it? The Hamza. We covered the Idhar last, the last few episodes. The six letters of the throat, they are the letters of Idhar, and of them is Hamza. Okay. With this, we come to the conclusion of today's episode. We will continue the rules of Noon, Sakin, and Tanween. Now, please don't get discouraged by the quantity of rules. These are very simple rules. It's just a matter of taking them one at a time. It doesn't require that much knowledge of Arabic. It doesn't require that much knowledge of any other science. It's just memorizing these simple rules. What occurs after the Noon, Sakin, or Tanween? If it's a particular letter, then that ruling will apply. So don't get discouraged. Persevere, persist, and recite the Quran to someone who is knowledgeable so that he can correct you in his recitation. I hope to see you next time. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.